The people who live and lead with the most joy and contentment are those who have clarity about their priorities. They know what they do best and fill their days with more of those activities. If you can delegate, delay, or drop it, it may not be a priority for you, or it shouldn't be. We're not saying that if you figure out your priorities, your life will be utopian. But you might as well stack the odds in your favor, right? You have a limited supply of days. The wisest among us understand there are just 52 Saturdays in a year to be present with their kids. Are there other things to do on a Saturday? Of course. But if you don't figure out how to say no to the good, you won't get to say yes to the great. What's best for you? This may be a question you have never considered. Perhaps you have let others decide what should be important. Perhaps your parents, your spouse, or even your boss. We all face tremendous pressure in this regard. External expectations about who we are and what we should do have a way of co-opting our value system. Many are told, for instance, they should go to college and perhaps even pursue an advanced degree. But why? Have you seen the statistics on jobless graduates? News outlets regularly run stories on the problem. It's practically a whole new genre of journalism. The indebted graduate who can explain Ulysses while ringing up your latte feature. Of course, there's nothing wrong with being a barista, as long as you want to be one or can afford to pay your college loan from the tip jar. The reality is that despite the intense social pressure, college isn't for everyone. In their book, Is College Worth It?, you have to do what's right for you. There is no point keeping up with the Joneses if they're going someplace you don't want to go. But you have to choose where you want to go before you can avoid the cultural drift. Identify your life accounts. Start by thinking of all the various compartments that make up your life. Most people can organize their lives into 7 to 12 distinct areas. We call these life accounts. This life accounts diagram is made up of 3 concentric circles emanating from the center, you. The circle of being. The innermost ring is a collection of activities focused solely on you in relation to yourself. It includes your spiritual, intellectual, and physical accounts. The circle of relating. The second ring is a collection of activities centered on you in relation to others, your marital, parental, and social accounts. The third ring is a collection of activities dealing with you in relation to your output, your vocation, job, avocation, hobbies, and financial accounts. This diagram is not a fixed or rigid model. It's just a way to help you recognize that your life is more than just one account. It's more than work. It's more than marriage. It's more than money. It's an interrelated collection of interests, responsibilities, dreams, and activities. Your job in this section of the life plan is to create your own chart of accounts. You want to write down a list of life accounts that are important to you. As you think through your own list, here are 4 considerations. Number 1, your life accounts are unique to you. If you're currently single, you might not have a marital account. If you're newly married, you might not have a parental account. You also may not be at the stage of life where you want to add an avocational account, an area of interest or hobby you pursue outside your main occupation. 2. Your life accounts can be named whatever you want. Choose whatever name is meaningful to you, though we find it best to apply specific names to the accounts when applicable. You can also choose an account that is broad in scope. Example, a single account for your entire family. Or narrow in scope, accounts for each member of your family, which can be really helpful because everyone has different needs. Again, it all depends on what's important to you and how narrowly you want to focus. 3. Your life accounts are interrelated. For the purpose of discussion, we are asking you to list them separately. But this is only a model, not reality. In reality, you exist as a whole being with a whole life. If, for example, your health is poor, it could negatively influence your marriage, your work, and possibly even your spiritual life. Try as we might, we can't isolate the influence of one area from the others. Still, we want to list them so we can give the appropriate amount of attention to each. 4. Your life accounts will change over time. We have updated our life accounts regularly over the years. How we prioritize them changes too. The important thing is to develop a list that reflects your life now. Your life plan is a living document that you will tweak and adjust as necessary for the rest of your life. Once you have your list of life accounts, it's time to evaluate how you fare in each. Determine the condition of each. We can't improve what we don't assess, so this is a time to review each account and determine where you are. First, we want to explain why we choose the term life accounts. Everyone understands how bank accounts work. They're a place to deposit your money, pay your bills, and accrue value. Moreover, each one has a specific balance. Some accounts have a growing balance. You have more than you need. You're spending less than you take in. The balance is increasing. If most of your accounts are in this condition, your financial future looks secure. Some accounts have a consistent balance. You have what you need. You are spending about what you take in. The balance is holding steady. If most of your accounts are in this condition, your present may be secure, but your future may be in jeopardy. Some accounts have a declining balance. You have less than you need. You're spending more than you take in. The balance may be overdrawn. If you have too many accounts in this condition, neither your present nor your future is secure. You risk going bankrupt. Now take this financial metaphor and apply it to your life accounts. Each has a specific balance. Some are growing, some are holding steady, some are declining or are overdrawn. For example, you're killing it in your soccer league, but your family misses you on weekends. Or maybe you're beating your goals at work, but your health account is overdrawn. You're eating too much junk food and you're not exercising regularly. Or perhaps you're in great shape physically, but your marriage has gone flat. You and your spouse have become like strangers living in the same house. Or maybe you have lost your job, but you have a wonderful circle of friends who stand with you. The point is, your life is a collection of accounts and each of them requires the right attention. The goal is to have a positive balance in each of your life accounts. But what exactly does that mean? In our experience, people have a positive account balance when they experience both passion and progress. These are two distinct but essential components. Passion relates to your enthusiasm for a specific life account. Are you in love with your spouse? Is that love growing or waning? What about your career? Are you passionate about your work or are you bored with it? Or what about your health? Do you love to exercise or do you hate it? Regardless, this is what we mean when we talk about passion.